Morning, everybody. Thanks for coming up to the session this early. Hopefully we can give you some good content on hosted voice. So I want to introduce my speaker today. Victor is from Telstra. As some of you may remember, he used to work at Microsoft a couple of years ago, and one of my esteemed colleagues back then. So Victor's going to present about hosted voice and how Lync and has matured in a hosted platform, specifically around how you can provide enterprise voice in a private cloud environment that's either hosted as part of your services or as part of a hosted services that Telstra offer.
Good morning. So today we will talk about the private cloud, and we will focus on Microsoft Lync. However, we will also touch on other services which can be provided out of private cloud. First of all, this is a conceptual overview of potential architectures. Some of these Telstra is doing in its own private cloud. Something is currently in roadmap. So I will also cover and discuss what is available, what is going to be available, so on. But the whole idea of this presentation is to give you understanding on what to expect from a private cloud. Is it Telstra private cloud or someone else private cloud? Okay, we will go to discuss three different options. The first one is infrastructure as a service. And secondly, we will discuss software as a service in two options, one multi-tenancy and one dedicated. I will show you a couple of scenarios for private cloud deployment and how to use those deployments. And obviously, we'll have time for questions. So first is infrastructure as a service. And you must understand that infrastructure as a service basically has the same concept as an on-premise solution. It is based on on-premise version of Lync. So basically, the full Lync deployment can be done. And Telstra, in this example, will provide you with a whole bunch of virtual machines for you to deploy Microsoft Lync. There are a number of options available how you're going to deploy Lync in this case. You can request just VMs from Telstra and do the operational system and application level yourself, or you can engage a third party, like a Telstra partner or partner of your choice, to deploy a Microsoft Lync for you in the data center, in the Telstra data center, or you can request a professional services from Telstra to deploy Microsoft Lync for you. From the licensing perspective, variety of options available. So you can provide your own licensing through the enterprise agreement with Microsoft, or you can purchase licensing from Telstra on a Splunk model. So it is available for both for software licensing part and as well as end user call licensing. This solution, as it's based on a full version of Lync, fully customizable, you will have access, you or your partner of choice will have full access to the software. So basically, you can customize, you can install any third-party applications on top of Lync. So for example, you can deploy conference center or call recording or any third-party add-ons on top of Lync. Most of integration options will be available. You can do a SIP integration to on-premise solutions, including all the supported IP PBXs, video conferencing, and so on, so on. The only limitation is coming from that the network is obviously routed network. It's not a stretch VLAN from your premise to a Telstra cloud. So some scenarios where you require a layer 2 network won't work. So you cannot stretch a cluster, for example, to put one host on premise, one host in an infrastructure as a service. But the rest of integration and customization is available. You can also stretch your Active Directory into the Telstra cloud. So you do not need to care about the Active Directory synchronization theme, et cetera, et cetera. However, it's optionally still available. So if you don't want to stretch your Active Directory into the Telstra cloud, you can deploy a source forest type of scenario in an infrastructure as a service and then do a synchronization between two. This is in case you want to bring more security into the deployment. Key difference, basically, in this case, you can deploy a link without any investment into your own data center, and you can consume as many resources as you want. You can go up and down anytime you want. You can order more virtual machines power or less, depends on the number of users you're going to deploy. However, this will require a Telstra IP VPN to access infrastructure as a service from your on-premise. And key consideration point, first of all, the quality of service, because the quality of service must be aligned through the whole environment. So it must be aligned with policies applied to your local network, to your WAN connectivity to the data center, and it also must be aligned with quality of service policies enabled on a within a virtual environment and service environment as well. And in this case, the partner or yourself or Telstra professional service must take care about that quality of service, because as you can imagine, a different teams within a Telstra look after a different environment component. So there will be a team who is enabling calls on a WAN connection. There is a team who is looking after the calls in infrastructure as a service. So it's up to you to bring those team on the same page. SIP trunking is available at on-premise level or in a data center level. So you basically can allocate a session border controller in an infrastructure as a service and bring it as close to the front end as possible. However, it depends on the scenario you're deploying Lync for. You might want to put a SIP trunk on premise. For example, if you're doing a lot of PSTN calls in and out and you want to keep media on a local network, you will put a SIP trunk termination point on premise and enable media bypass, so the media will always flow from endpoint to the local gateway and then back to PSTN rather than flow every time to a data center where the SIP trunk can be terminated. But if you're doing a lot of conferencing out of Lync, in this case you will bring the SIP termination point as close to the conference bridge, which is sits on a front-end server. Again, to be sure that all the media happens locally at the network level. This is a very brief description of architecture. So as you can see, there are two data centers. They are located in different geographical locations, for example, Melbourne and Sydney. There is on-premise where you've got all your Lync clients, and Lync clients will have access through the IP VPN directly to the front-end pool. You may deploy one pool in one data center and a backup pool and a secondary data center. In this case, Telstra will provide just a set of VMs, or Telstra can also provide the whole lot. So it's a matter of cost, basically. Each data center may have a DMZ, so a dedicated perimeter network with direct access to internet to give you all the remote access functionality. So all the users outside of your local network will go through the edge server and reverse proxy. All locals from your sites will go directly to the front end. Again, a SIP trunk can be enabled, going to session border controller, to PSTN, and this device can be located. It's just a logical diagram here. So this device can be located on premise or in a cloud. Again, Active Directory can be stretched into the data center. You can have the same Active Directory forest. You do not need to care about the synchronization, etc. As well as the other infrastructure components can be deployed in the data center level as well. With this deployment, you can bring some of the components of Lync on-premise if you wish to. For example, if you're deploying a huge branch somewhere and you're expecting a lot of conferencing load in that branch, you might end up having a standard edition deployed locally on-premise to support a local conferencing. For the smaller allocations, you can bring all the loads into the cloud. From the interoperability, as I mentioned previously, as it's based on the full version of Lync and using the same architecture as on-premise would use, all the interoperability available today and certified will be available for infrastructure as a service scenario. SIP communication will be supported with on-premise IP PBXs. They must be supported, so they must be listed in Open Interoperability Program website at Microsoft. You can do video conferencing integration. You can use your on-premise exchange to provide unified messaging for Lync in a cloud in this scenario, or you can have a exchange in a cloud and have Lync on-premise. Either options, all the hybrid scenario will be available. You can also leverage all the APIs available on Lync side to build on top of Lync. So basically, if you're looking for a most flexible and customizable solution, the infrastructure as a service is your solution. The next one, we will discuss the software as a service in multi-tenant. Sorry, you have a question?
So before we get into software as a service, I think there was a question there as well. Do you have a question there? Just want to explain the context behind software as a service. Most of you have used or heard about Office 365 and how you guys leverage Office 365 for Exchange, SharePoint, and some Lync services. Office 365 does not offer enterprise voice. It offers Lync IM and Lync conferencing. Okay. So when you're thinking about using Office 365, you can use Office 365 for Exchange, SharePoint, and if you want to leverage enterprise voice as a hosted service and as software as a service, that is where this plays. Okay. So the next couple of things are two types of software as a service that Telstra offer, and think of it in that context where you're procuring licensing from Microsoft as a service or as a subscription model, and you're leveraging 365 for Exchange and SharePoint and using enterprise voice as a service from Telstra. Having said that, you can still continue to use your Exchange and SharePoint on-premise if you already have them. So this doesn't tie back necessarily into 365. It can tie back into your on-premise infrastructure as well.
Thanks, Owen. Yeah, unfortunately for multi-tenancy option, the enterprise voice not available because the software service multi-tenant is based on a Lync hosting pack, and the Lync hosting pack does not provide enterprise voice functionality at this stage. So, however, going further, Telstra might enable a PSTN, outgoing PSTN calls for multi-tenancy. It doesn't provide the full enterprise voice functionality, but at least it will give you an option to make external calls from that environment. In this option, the Telstra will fully operate the environment for Lync or Exchange or SharePoint or all of those loads. The customer will have access to the theme portal for end-user provisioning, and also there will be a kind of a level of feature set you can enable for a different group of users. Server licenses will be included into the service fee. So because in this particular scenario, Telstra has to own the server license, and it will be included and covered by the service fee. But for the CAL licensing, you can leverage your enterprise agreement or Office 365 subscription to cover the end user licensing. No customization, it has to be consumed as is. So again, the only choice you've got is a level of or set of feature sets available for different users. No integration options for multi-tenancy. So you will not be able to integrate it into your on-premise PBX, unfortunately. Again, no access to the software. All access to the services will be done through the edge and published services. All the end-user provisioning is done through the FIM portal. Active Directory sync can be enabled for easier end-user provisioning, but no single sign-on for a multi-tenancy option. So it supports only from identity option. It can support a cloud identity only, which means the users accessing the link in the cloud will have to provide a different set of credentials. So basically, they will need to enter a password. In this case, the SIP domain will be fully provisioned out of Lync in the cloud, and no SIP split domain at this stage supported. So it's a limitation of the product itself. And Telstra are working very closely with Microsoft folks to see if there is any opportunity to enable that functionality in the future. So just to let you know that the whole Telstra design and architecture is provided by Microsoft consulting services. So basically, there are a number of Microsoft consultants sitting on the Telstra premise every day, building that infrastructure for us. So it's everything is based on recommendations and reference architecture provided by vendor. It's not something we trying to deploy ourselves.
It's part of the strategic alliance with one of the 12 in the world working with Microsoft to build out this infrastructure.
If you want to find details, so please visit a Telstra stand at the exhibition party. So key consideration, directory sync can be done through the internet. So basically, multi-tenancy does not require a Telstra IP VPN for you to consume that service. Media and signaling traffic will also go across the internet. So this is why you may not expect a very strict SLAs from Telstra on this service. However, if you still want to have a best possible quality of voice and video, you can enable Telstra IP VPN to provide a priority for real-time media traffic. Again, no enterprise voice for this option.
So just think of that service as those of you that have conditions around not offshoring your data. Again, this works in that context, right?
It also works for companies who are hiring some contractors for a temporary on a temporary base. So, for example, they're hiring 100 people to do a particular job for 2 months. They can provision that service out of Telstra for them to be able to communicate back to the employees. And then after that contract is over, they can decommission that service easily. So this is also are very suitable for small organizations. It's kind of a controlled Skype kind of thing. So from the network architecture perspective, as you can see, wrong button all the time. So there is a shared infrastructure which will provide all the services like Active Directory, Cloud Exchange, Cloud Link, Cloud SharePoint, and This link is based on a hosting pack. Exchange and SharePoint also customized to meet the requirements for multi-tenancy. All the services are published in a DMZ, so no direct access, no direct client access to the front end. It's all going through the published services. The Telstra IP VPN is optional. This is if you want to guarantee the quality of service, or all the services can be consumed through the pure internet connection. Again, just to illustrate, all the services are sit in a secure, isolated network, and all the services are published to the customers through the shared infrastructure of edge service and traverse proxy. Customers may have to deploy a directory sync for end-user provisioning, or may decide not to deploy it and do the provisioning of users directly from the cloud. For a dedicated option, you want to?
Comment? So by far, what we've seen is this has been like the biggest ask from customers in terms of having a software as a service for pure enterprise voice play. And the way that we are seeing people use this is from a 365 licensing model, but however, using that licensing against software as a service provided by Telstra and so on.
With dedicated model, it's a different, because it is based on the full version of Lync. So in this model, Telstra will deploy a dedicated and isolated instance per customer. For this option, Telstra will still fully maintain and operate the environment. The customer will not have access, direct access to the software for any customization or installing an additional applications on top of it. There will be a theme portal for end-user provisioning. Licensing can be, again, provided through the license mobility. You can leverage your enterprise agreement or Office 365 subscription to cover all the licensing.
So, just a question. And do you want to explain the relevance of FIM here in terms of all the three models and why FIM is a good idea to have either through the
service? We will talk about the FIM later during the presentation. So no customization available. However, Telstra is looking to deploy an application catalog for you. So for example, if there is a lot of successful implementation of a particular contact center on top of Lync within infrastructure as a service, Telstra can bring it as a product into the dedicated software as a service. So we will have an option in sometime in the future to add features to Lync, but it's not available today. However, you will not be able to customize and do some customization yourself. Limited integration to on-premise solution. Basically, you are limited to a SIP chunk, which means some video conferencing scenario integration are not possible. However, to a certified IP PBXs on-premise, you can do a SIP chunk. Again, no access.
Can it be integrated to multiple PBXs?
Yeah, absolutely. So it can be integrated. It doesn't really matter. It's not a single SIP chunk, right? You can integrate into different PBXs if they support it. If that integration is supported by Microsoft, and that PBX are listed in Open Interoperability Program, you can deploy a SIP chunk to that PBX. Yes, question?
Can I just throw a scenario at you? So we're basically, our goal is to get all our servers off-premise and into the cloud. So that's Lync, Exchange, the whole lot. So we're going off 365. Now, with Lync, because it's all in the cloud, with Office 365, we don't have enterprise voice. So will this give us the gap?
Uh, Dedicated one, yes. So dedicated will give you all the enterprise voice functionality. Unfortunately, it's not available like today. If you go to Telstra and say, I want it today, it's not. however, it is in nearest roadmap. So basically, we're deploying it now. So
if you want it today, your solution is infrastructure as a service
cloud,
right? So you get enterprise voice and you can replace it.
I think that'd be good because following the theme of getting everything off premise, like, because you don't have to worry about DR, obviously, deaf phones and your own phone system is a big thing, piece of DR. So getting that out of on premise into, say, Telstra and having your voice hosted there and hooking that up to Office 365 would be fantastic.
So have a chat with Joe on the roadmap and the timing around that.
Yeah. Awesome. Thanks. Let's continue. We'll have time for questions at the end. I hope so. Software as a service dedicated model actually allow you to access all the services again through the reverse proxy and edge. So the client will not be able to access front end directly. This is because the internal environment, even if it's dedicated and per customer, we're still trying to meet very strict SLAs from the security perspective and performance perspective. So this is why all the end client access will be done through the reverse proxy and edge services. A customer instance will have our own Active Directory per customer, so no shared infrastructure at all. Theme provides a self-service portal, and I have a video at the end with demo on how the theme portal looks like from the admin perspective, how to provision end users. Also, there is end user part of the portal where end users can configure some of their personal features. If we have time, we will go through that video and you will see the end user experience as well as admin experience. So again, all the services like mailboxes, SharePoint, and Lync sits in a protected network without any access from external. All the services will go through the edge functionality, or SharePoint will be published externally through the reverse proxy. Again, customer SIP domain have to be fully provisioned of the cloud infrastructure, no split domain support at this stage. But it doesn't mean that you cannot do any hybrid scenarios. You can still deploy Lync on-premise and Lync a cloud, but you will have to deploy different SIP domains and establish a federation between two.
So just question for you, and so we can extrapolate that. What does it mean? What does no split domain mean?
So no split domain means that you cannot have the same SIP domain for on-premise deployment and a cloud deployment.
In a Lync
correct. Environment, so which means you cannot split load, saying I want to enable some users with enterprise voice and host them locally, and enable some with instant messaging and presence and enterprise voice and host them in a Telstra cloud and have the same SIP domain for both groups. No.
Sorry.
However, you can deploy different SIP domains. Yep.
Sorry, go ahead. Question.
So, can you have, like you said, you needed to enable federation. So, have two SIP domains and enable federation. It's possible to have multiple SIP domains within the one Lync deployment.
Yep.
Can you do that instead of having federation? Like, say, can you deploy a stretched SIP, a stretched Lync configuration? So, one topology with multiple domains.
No,
is the restriction, okay, here's where I'm going, is the restriction, is it an AD restriction or is it a DNS restriction?
It's basically AD restriction and Lync restriction. So basically in this case, there will be a dedicated cloud Active Directory and the cloud Lync deployment will be based on that cloud Active Directory, and there is a theme synchronization between two.
So yeah, Eddie Sync is storing the objects in the cloud from that perspective.
Yes, basically, but it is a product limitation, right? It's different to Office 365 products, so where you have a split domain available. And again, we're working with Microsoft to see if in the future we can deploy the same functionality for a private cloud, so you can stretch your SIP domain into a cloud, because it's very handy. For identity options, you've got single sign-on, but it will require a trusted relationship between cloud Active Directory and on-premise Active Directory. You can choose a cloud identity, which means you don't need to do a trusted relation with optional directory sync, similar to what you've got in multi-tenancy option. Key consideration, it will require a Telstra PVPN for single sign-on. So it's mandatory for single sign-on. You cannot do single sign-on through the internet. However, if you choose to use a cloud identity, directory sync can still work through the internet only. Median, yes, question?
Password sync?
Password sync, no, not at this stage. So you have to have a trusted relation to do a password, to use the same password. Media can flow through the internet or can use a private Telstra network to provide the best quality.
Just question there. So
yeah.
We still need to have a trusted relationship between the on-premise Active Directory and the cloud.
Yes, for single sign-on, yes. It is mandatory, it's required. So from the network architecture perspective, you can see each customer will have a dedicated instance of services in a Telstra isolated network. Services can be published per customer. Customers may have access through the internet or through the Telstra IP VPN. So different options are available here. Closer look. So this is a Telstra infrastructure, a Telstra network, sits in a cloud. You've got all your Lync deploy here. All the edge and reverse proxy with a dedicated Active Directory and a FIM portal per customer. You have Active Directory services to be trusted through the trusted relationship to your local Active Directory for a single sign-on. There is a directory sync route going through the FIM instances. And customer have to operate that instance themselves. Telstra will provide all the guidelines and assistance for to build that service. But eventually, it will be on a customer premise, and customer is responsible for that service. What's the point? You will then go and host everything in infrastructure as a service in this case. All access from a Lync client, doesn't matter are they on your premise or in internet, will go through the reverse proxy and edge. So no direct access to front end, as you can see. So this option also provides a connectivity through the SIP trunk to a PSTN, through the session border controller, and that session border controller can also be connected back to your premise to your existing IP PBX, for example. However, I can tell you that as all the access going through the reverse proxy and edge server, there is no way to provide a full call admission control in enterprise voice environment. We're considering a different architecture and topology, but to enable call admission control, it will require a direct access to the front-end server from a client for this feature to be available. But there is another security. There's a whole bunch of limitations on the security and responsibility, and so on, so on. So at this stage, we not do this, but we consider to do it in the future if we find a suitable solution. Again, each customer will have a dedicated instance. Every instance will be centrally provisioned through the a single provisioning and management system. However, once it's provisioned, it will sit in isolated network, having no access to other instances. And there is just a management subset of tools which will still communicate back to a Telstra managed suite for performance monitoring, upgrades, etc. So all the software will be evergreen. Basically, if Microsoft issue a new version of software and Telstra do all the internal certification and testing, that software will be rolled out to all the instances, and the customer will be obviously receive a note about that is going to happen. We also will assist the customers through the migration process if it's require any Lync client upgrades as well. For the identity options, I just want to discuss it a little bit in details. So single sign-on, cloud identity with directory sync or cloud identity only. So for a single sign-on, in this particular scenario, customer has its own Active Directory on-premise with the customer .com domain. We will deploy a new domain in a Telstra data center, which will be a customer cloud, for example. We will need to establish a trust between two Active Directories. Again, there is a number of options currently in discussion. So it can be a single-way trust or a two-way trust, depends on SLAs you're looking for, as well as what security features are you looking for. But even if we're talking about two-way trust, you don't be too scared. You're not going to trust the whole Telstra Active Directory infrastructure. It's matter to trust just a single service account in that cloud Active Directory. Customer operates its own direct sync, as I mentioned previously. Telstra will provide all the guidelines how to operate it, and also will provide assistance in setting that service. Customer users will log in into the local PC using the local Active Directory account, and they will not be requested to enter any new credentials when they're accessing the link in the cloud. So they will basically get into the service without any sign-on pop-ups. So just briefly to demonstrate what's going on. So we've got two domains, a trust between them. User will use its own credentials to log in on a PC. When it's going to access the Lync credentials or the Lync service, there will be no request to enter any credentials. So it will just use the credentials the user provided when he logs in into local PC. How it works in reality, again, there is an Active Directory sits in a Telstra cloud with a theme synchronization service, which will go all the user accounts through the directory sync, and those accounts will trust similar accounts in an Active Directory through the trust relationship. Then theme is responsible to provisioning users on all that services, such as Exchange, Lync, SharePoint. Admins, the customer admins will have access to that theme portal for end user enabling. If you disable user in your Active Directory locally, through the directory sync, that account will be disabled for all the cloud services as well. So it will happen automatically. cloud identity, as simple as this. There are two different Active Directory. There is no trust between them. There is optionally a directory sync for end user provisioning, so that all the accounts will be synced, but you will need to provide a new set of the new password for cloud account for users to access the cloud services. How it works? Again, two domains, no trust between them. User access a local PC using a local Active Directory account, but when it's breaching out the Telstra cloud services, there will be a pop-up to, will be a prompt to enter a cloud ID credentials. Similar infrastructure, similar architecture, except there is no trust. But the rest, all the theme is the same, and theme is responsible again to provisioning end users. With this, we can go to a cloud scenarios. And first one is infrastructure as a service. So imagine that the customer has an existing on-premise IP telephony based on a supported IP PBX. It can be Cisco or whatever. They deploying Lync Enterprise Voice within infrastructure as a service using Telstra provisioned VMs. There will be a number of SIP trunks established between two environments. And why do we need a number of SIP trunks? Because we're trying to control, first of all, the class of service for end users. If you want to limit the access to PSTN and other call routings, as well as to manage how the media flow use your network. Just to illustrate the infrastructure, so you see there is two data centers with primary and backup pool in infrastructure as a service, and you've got IP PBX on premise with a mixture of IP PBX phones and Lync Enterprise voice clients enabled on premise. So there is a number of SIP trunks configured, and as in most cases, you do not need to have a dedicated licensing. You are not limited on how many SIP trunks you would like to enable. From the peer-to-peer call perspective, and it's quite simple. So the signaling will flow through the call control on-premise, then through the SIP trunk, back to the link in the cloud, and link will communicate to the link client. So with media bypass enabled, the media will use G711 and it will flow directly. So no need for media to go back into the data center. So you just save a lot of bandwidth in this particular scenario.
Just a quick question there. The SIP trunks, what if the PBX is not SIP enabled or IP enabled?
If the PBX is not SIP enabled, there is always an option to put an IP gateway, a certified IP gateway in front of PBX connected using ISDN to a PBX, and then use a SIP trunk through that IP gateway. For the peer-to-peer call happening between locations, what you can do, you can use another SIP trunk which is configured to use a more efficient codec. And then you can also configure that SIP trunk to use a local media termination point or transcoder located on the remote location. So what will happen with signaling pass, again, going through the link front end. However, the media, what will happen, on the signaling part, that SIP trunk will provide an IP address of the local MTP as a destination for media, and Lync will be able to establish a local G711 call to the media termination point, like it was the same network, while there will be a G729, for example, going through the your WAN infrastructure. With a conference call, I'm not going to put a signaling here because it will be a mess. However, you may have, again, a different configuration of SIP chunk, which will require a local MTP on at the data center level, and will guide all the existing IP handsets to use G729, for example, for that conference call, while the Lync, which does not support media bypass for the conferencing load, will have to use G711 locally to the media termination point. So the PSTN call comes in, can go through the a SIP gateway located at data center level, or if it's going through there, for example, if you still have a PBX connected to a PSTN, it can actually come through here, and then again, depends on the SIP trunk configuration, can use a G711 back to that MTP at the data center level. Next example is a cloud-to-cloud example, and this is based on infrastructure as a service or software as a service. Lync deployment doesn't really matter for that particular scenario. Assume that the client wants to integrate existing TPIT to provide remote call control to Lync users, and the customer wants to enable dial-in conferencing on Lync. So what we've got? We've got a telster data center where the Lync is deployed. We've got a TPIT cloud with a set of session border controllers. We've got TPIT IP handsets locally with Lync clients enabled for remote call control. Yes, a question. TPIT is a Telstra IP telephony. So TPIT is a managed telephony offer from Telstra. It's based on BroadWorks call control system. So again, back to our scenario. When the user logs in into a Lync client, it will provide credentials to log in, and then Lync client will communicate to Lync front end, where that user is configured with a line server URI in the format in the remote call control format, where the domain is a TPIT domain, and Lync server has a static route, and he knows where to find the call control for that particular scenario. So it will establish a SIP communication to the session border controller, which sits somewhere in a Telstra TPIT network, and will also provide a user credentials using a client SIP domain. With this information, BroadWorks will check a database and see if that particular user has rights to control a TPIT handset and establish the signaling path to the handset to check the current status of the handset, to sync the presence information, etc., as well as to provide a control of that handset. So with this enabled, Lync client will be able to place external calls controlling the TPIT handset, so all the media will remain on TPIT, as well as all incoming calls will have pop-ups in the Lync client where the user can answer the call. From the media perspective, we will just look after a conference call, which is using a dial-in conferencing on Lync. However, we want to use a tipped handset, and we're doing a remote call control again. So we're providing a dial-in number to a tipped handset saying, yeah, I want to place a call to that particular number. Tipped handset will talk to a broad soft call control, and there is some magic happens. If that SIP trunk we are using to enable dial-in conferencing and a tipped domain has the same enterprise ID, the BroadWorks will allow the media to flow directly between endpoints belongs to the same enterprise ID, which means the media will flow directly on a corporate network rather than go through the TBS, TPIT session border controller back to PSTN, through the PSTN back to Lync SIP connect. So it won't happen. It will go directly. At this stage, all the Lync SIP trunk deployments will require the media flow through. So the SIP gateway will try to remain in a media path. However, it will not do any transcoding. It will just bypass all the media through without any transcoding. So the same will apply to remote locations. So remote locations will be able to use Telstra PVPN for media flow to dial-in services, dial-in conferencing services. Again, no PSTN involvement. And the PSTN calls into dial-in will flow directly through the Lync SIP trunk available at the data center level. With this, I would like to actually to summarize all the three options. So what we've got, software as a service dedicated, which gives you enterprise voice, which gives you a dedicated infrastructure, so no shared infrastructure. It's all yours. You can go up and down. You can deploy Exchange, SharePoint, Lync, or just Lync, for example, in this scenario. Again, Exchange, Lync server, full version of Lync, full version of SharePoint, and some additional compliance archiving is available as part of that service. What we're going to introduce, more and more applications into that option. It requires a private network if you're looking to deploy single sign-on. However, the services can also be consumed through the Intranet. For the self-management, it is a theme portal. So all the end-user provisioning can be done through the theme portal. If you would like to introduce changes into the a policy, for example, you want to disable remote access for a group of users, you can also do a change request through the help desk to enable that, those changes. But again, the theme portal is available for admins to end-user provisioning and also available for end-users to enable, disable some end-user features. Evergreen, yes, with a 6 months notice, so customers will be notified that Telstra is going to upgrade the software release. And it is mandatory, so you cannot say, oh, I don't want to upgrade, I actually want to keep the older version for whatever the reason. Interoperability and integration is basic. So it's again, it's a SIP trunk to your on-premise. And we have a roadmap to deliver more and more options for integration, but it's not available today. Basically, it's locked with a feature set and has to be consumed as is. It is annual-based contract with a number of users which can go up and down, that you can and the monthly pay can be adjusted. Integration with, yes, as I mentioned, there is integration options through the SIP chunk to on-premise. And there will be going to an extra applications catalog available. The dedicated service is available today, except enterprise voice, which is currently in the process of enablement. Okay. You can deploy Lync today if you want for instant messaging and presence. And once enterprise voice is available, you can add that functionality. Yes, for dedicated, you can also enable conferencing in the cloud. For software as a service multi-tenant, the key difference, it is based on a Lync hosting pack, not a full version. Exchange and SharePoint is also customized to meet the requirements of multi-tenancy. This is shared infrastructure, a single Active Directory forest for the all customers, where the customers is divided through the organizational units. Architecture is similar to what you would expect from Office 365, but a little bit different at this stage. Private network not required, only if you want to provide quality of service, but all the services can be consumed through the internet. Again, theme management portal for end-user provisioning. Evergreen, yes, similar concept, 6 months notice. It's even more locked with the features. This is a per-user per-month bill. You can purchase it just for a single month for hundreds of users if you need to provide that service quickly on a temporary base. No enterprise voice. But we've got outgoing PSTN calls in roadmap for that feature.
Just quickly on that, what does that mean?
It means that it's similar to Skype. So you can place a PSTN call, but you do not have a DID number for receiving PSTN calls from outside. It's going to be available soon because the hosting pack for Lync 2013, and yes, obviously, all the services are based on Lync 2013, not 2010. And Hosting Pack has been available just for a number of months since it's released for 2013. This is why it's currently in the deployment process as well. Infrastructure as a service, first of all, available today and has been available for quite a while, and we have some customers already deploying the Lync in infrastructure as a service. It's a virtual environment within a Telstra data center with a set of machines with different options for provisioning and management. So again, you can have it's fully managed by Telstra or fully managed in-house, or you can engage a third party to provide that service for you. There is a private network required for infrastructure as a service. However, the infrastructure service has internet access on a data center level to provide remote access for users on an internet. For the provisioning and management, you've got the full Lync management tool capabilities, including PowerShell and control panel. So you can do optimization, customization, whatever you want. Evergreen service, optional, it's not mandatory. If you want to stay on an older version, you're happy to do it. If you want to be on early adoptions program, you're more than welcome to do it as well. Integration options, basically same as you would expect for on-premise. Again, the key difference and benefits for this is a fully customizable, fully flexible solution. So for the licensing, various options available. You can provide licensing for operational system as well. So in this case, all you need to purchase from Telstra is the set of VMs with particular requirements, and then provide your own licensing to cover the operational system. Or you can purchase operational system as part of the service based on a SPLA model. Any hybrid scenarios and placing SCP on-premise available for you, so you can mix and match, have a hybrid solutions for a different group of users or even for the same SIP domain. Again, it's available today. Yeah, please do it.
Thanks, Alvin. Yeah, so in terms of professional services associated with the CPE, we can provide the whole end-to-end solution and bundle it up and provide it as an OPEX model. So we're certainly working on the consumption model, pure software as a service, which you can dial up and down. But even today, we can bundle it up as an end-to-end solution and deliver it.
Thank you, Joe. With this, we still got some time. If you want, we can go through the.
So just pausing on that. Do you guys have questions? I think there is a question there.
Yeah, and just a quick question. Is there a reason why Telstra didn't offer the hybrid solution in terms of the Lync 2013?
What classify hybrid?
So, yeah. So you would have your Lync online in the 365 cloud, and you would deploy a Lync server purely for the telephony.
Let me answer that question. First of all, with infrastructure as a service option, you can do it. You can have, with infrastructure as a service, it's similar to on-premise, so you can do a hybrid solution. However, the Microsoft actually discontinued that as a hybrid voice.
So what that means is you can have a user that's fully on Lync Online or 365 for Lync IM and conferencing, and another user that's in Telstra infrastructure as a service consuming Lync IM conferencing and enterprise voice. You cannot split the workload for a individual user between Lync Online and and infrastructure as a service.
This is
that has been deprecated.
Yeah, this is just a limitation of the product. It's not just Telstra don't want to do it, right? It's a limitation in the product itself.
I guess moving from that, because I mean I'm a 365 user at the moment, but not with Telstra, right? It's we're directly with Microsoft at the moment, and obviously in other parts of the world there are other SIP providers that link into the 365 solution and make that seamless.
So again, I mean, there was one provider in the US, Jaja, and that has been deprecated as well. So there is no provider that can do enterprise voice in the cloud. Even back then, it was called a simple voice or link to phone, really. And that really just provided a DID to call in and out, but not enterprise voice features. There was no ACDQs, no response groups, no contact center integration, nothing of that sort. Right. So today, if you want to become an enterprise voice user and you're currently an Office 365 Lync Online user, the only way to do that is to move that user to an on-premise version, either in your data center or in Telstra infrastructure as a service.
Okay, so we do have your ways, guys. So
thanks to our sponsors and Jabra and Plantronics. And if there's no more questions, I think he does have a couple of. Yeah, go ahead, Joe.
Thanks. Any other questions? Yes.
What models will support IVR and contact center?
Sorry, can you repeat?
What models of deployment will support IVR systems and contact centers?
So the question is what model of those three will support a contact center and IVR? So obviously the infrastructure as a service will support the contact center, so we can deploy any available and certified contact center on top of Lync, and you can deploy them on premise and integrate it into the Lync in the cloud, or you can deploy them directly into the cloud infrastructure and enabled that feature on top of Lync. Both versions of software as a service will not provide that functionality so far, but we're looking to enable something in a dedicated model. But it's not available today and will not be available tomorrow. It's in a future roadmap.
What is the time frame for voice?
For enterprise voice, I'll let Draw to answer that question.
So just to... Yeah, it's
come and see me if you're interested.
Just learning, Telstra is pushing itself. So I'm from the Telstra Enterprise. We work in Joe closely to get enterprise voice on there. You can imagine users being the biggest telco of the country.
Give them some money, that's a back.
On our platform. So we be our first customers to get this one. So we pushing.
Sure. You're not allowed to, you're Telstra.
For you, courtesy Telstra, I'll give you a SIP trunk.
Please.
Yeah, the SIP trunk.
Come to our stand and answer the prime
draw. Yes, question.
Any truth to the rumor that the core capabilities of Skype are becoming Lync?
The question is about the rumors about the Skype call capability. Coming to Lync and Selwyn.
What do you mean by Skype capabilities? Because Lync can do dial in, dial out, and
I can make phone calls. You're from Australia.
So you can do that on. So you're asking for Lync Enterprise Voice as a hosted service by Microsoft, not by Telstra.
Well, it's sort of
doing
that now with Skype, right?
Yeah, I see. So let me answer this in two parts. One is enterprise voice play is a completely different play to what Skype offers in the cloud as a dial-out and dial-in service, right? So you've got to take that into context. And we are here we want to describe Lync as a enterprise feature set and Skype as a consumer feature set. There will always be that differentiation. So if you want to have a hosted enterprise play replacing your PABX in the cloud as a service, today that's by our partners like Telstra. Right. From a Skype perspective and to integration into Lync, we've already announced that, or it is there today, from a Skype to Lync audio and instant messaging and presence is already available. So you can actually add a Skype user on your Lync 2010 or 2013 systems, and you can actually talk to a Skype user from Lync. Absolutely. So Skype has to log in through a Microsoft MSA account, and that transition is already happening. So if you actually open a Skype ID today, you can't actually have a Skype ID per se. It is you log in via an MSA or a Microsoft account ID, right? So that transition is already happening. Video is coming, and we've already announced it publicly as well to say that video is coming.
And by the way, the Skype Federation is available for all three options we discussed today. So we can enable Federation with other companies deployed Lync, or with a public instant messaging and presence such as Skype, for all three options. For the similar functionality as you see in the Skype, so you can actually make an external call to EPS10 from Skype. This is going to be available for multi-tenancy soon, so you will not have a DID number to receive call, but you can still make a call outside. So it's similar to what you've got in Skype today. You will have it in a multi-tenancy option for private cloud thing, yeah, in the future. We have time for a couple of more questions.
Do you want to play the video?
Or if you want, we can play the video for...
Well, generally,
That is the bit that's... No, I mean, that is the bit that's already available right now, right? I mean, the whole concept behind this is how do you reach a massively connected network, right? So you have Lync Enterprise in your offices, and you want to reach out to consumers, you want to reach out to other Lync users. So that connection point is our first goal, and enabling all services between Lync and Skype is the vision set here. So that's, and clearly the demarcation point is Skype for consumers and Lync for enterprise users. So today, from my Lync app on my phone, the Lync app is for 2013 is available on iOS, Android, and Windows Phone, right? So you can actually do a VoIP call out to a user as long as you are enterprise voice enabled, right? So that functionality is already there within Lync.
So I actually would like to continue with this and show you the end user experience and the theme portal for what is today, what's available today from Telstra Cloud. No, there is audio.
It's demonstrable at the stand as well if you want to talk to the
administrator again.
Can you? Okay, let me talk through then. This is how you access the theme portal, and this is the
it's now navigating to.
Oh, can you just mute it then, please? So this is how you provision the user. So all the feature set is through the theme portal. You can enable a Lync for user. You can choose the picture, and it will be populated through the whole Active Directory in the cloud for all the services. Or it will be available on the Exchange and SharePoint as well. So you enable Lync access, you choose the Lync conferencing policy, you enable some loads and services for the user, validate what is enabled, and then user is basically provisioned. So with this, user able to go into Lync client, sign in. You see the picture is populated, and through the federation, Lync user can communicate externally, can do a persistent chat, can do all the voice video and web collaboration. So basically, a similar end-user experience which you would expect from on-premise deployment.
So that is for all three services? Or?
Yes, this is for all three services.
So you would have a similar experience. So you would have a similar experience from an infrastructure as a service for enterprise voice enablement as well.
Yeah. So. Basically, there will be a very brief show on how the end user portal look like. So what user can enable for himself. But as you can see, yeah, here it is. This user logs in into his personal theme portal web page. And you will see what functionalities are available for the end user as well.
So we are coming to the end of the session. So if you have questions, reach out to us. Or we'll be outside and downstairs at the showcase as well. And the Telstra guys have the their stand too, so you can reach out there too.
Yeah, I think we can do more live demo as well at the stand.
So thanks for coming, guys, and just want to call out thanks for coming on an early start straight after the Wednesday night. And also thanks to Telstra for sponsoring and actually doing the talk today.
Yeah, thank you much. Appreciated you come so early after probably a tough night yesterday.
We are just glad it's not Friday morning.